Good evening, Trinidad and Tobago. I know it is 7 o'clock and this is traditionally the time for the 7 o'clock news. But we have some urgent issues to discuss and I was prepared to wait until 8. But there are some people that we need to get in the interview and it's going to be multiples of interviews to make the point. And the point of this video is going to, and I want to tell you now, some of the things you're about to hear, not going to be easy to listen to. Some of what you are about to hear, it's not going to be easy to listen to. Public health care in Trinidad and Tobago is a criminal organization. Too many people have died in this country from waiting for ambulances to getting mistreated, maldiagnosis, malpractice in public health. People have lost their lives directly as a result of the failure of public health in Trinidad to live up to its remit. This morning I asked a question because Brent Hector of Carnage posted a picture. And the picture he posted was the Carnage Health Center list of days and times for service. And it got me wondering, what does this cost? We know we spend $5 billion a year. We spend $5 billion a year on public health. But we don't know what that costs. I've said too many times to count that the country is 41 semi-autonomous regions called constituencies and that all budgets should be calculated to make sure that those 41 semi-autonomous regions are able to deliver public goods and services to the people. So what does that mean when your healthcare budget is $5 billion a year? And that's not capital costs. All of the costs to build hospitals, the Coover Hospital was built by the Chinese, Point Fortin and Arima hospitals are being built by loans. So none of the $5 billion takes care of capital costs. The $5 billion, believe it or not, is supposed to be operational costs, stock and inventory, salaries, $5 billion. So that means if the Chinese built the Coover Hospital for billions of dollars, and Point Fortin and Arima are being built now for hundreds of millions of dollars. And none of the hospitals have been paid from our recurring loan payments are not coming out of this $5 billion. What is the $5 billion being spent on? By my calculation, 41 constituencies into $5 billion is $122 million per constituency. $122 million per constituency in Trinidad and Tobago per year. That's $12 million plus a month. $10 million plus a month. How do you spend $10 million on a spattering of health centers for failing hospitals? Port of Spain, Mount Hope, San Fernando, Scarborough are four failing hospitals. Not one of them get a passing grade. Sangre Grande and a couple of health centers, some of them get called hospitals. How do you spend? This is what I worked out today. I asked Trinidad and Tobago to just count with me. A health center, the size of the health center in Carnage. If we were renting the square foot facility, because I'm in the real estate business, I tell you, the maximum amount of money they could get for that facility is $100,000 a month. That is almost twice the value of what they could get for it. So let's say they get $100,000 a month for that. If we're renting the facility, it's $100,000 a month. If it's three nurses a shift, and we're paying them $8,000 a month, and I do not think nurses get $8,000 a month in Trinidad, but if we're paying them $8,000 a month, then that's three shifts for 24 hours. And I know they say they work 8 to 4. Our health centers close at 4. Our health centers are like mechanic yards. In fact, mechanic yards run later. Our health centers run like a business day. KFC opens longer. But if you had three shifts of nurses, of three nurses at $8,000 each, that's $72,000. Nine nurses. And if you're paying public health doctors $33,000 a month, and I am being ridiculous, because public health doctors are usually interns straight out of med school. But if you're paying them $33,000 a month and you have three to run it around the clock, that's the next $100,000. If we throw in another $50,000 for lights, phone, security, that's still not $500,000. That is still not $500,000 a month. But we're spending $10 million a month. Where is the other $9.5 million a month in Diggle Martin West alone going? Where? Where? The Progressive Empowerment Party has shown the nation that we could operate purpose-built healthcare centers, 41 throughout the country, at less than $1 million a month, with professional first world service security dedicated ambulances. That is $41 million. We're spending $5 billion. So if besides the $41 million, for the 41 proper mini hospitals, each constituency gets a mini hospital that works 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Accident and emergency. An accident and emergency is a serious issue. Accident and emergency deals with everything that is required to hold, treat, stabilize. That's what accident and emergency is for. Minor surgery suites, 24 hours, 7 days a week. That means that you need to go and get your food bag. You can go 1 o'clock in the morning and do that blood test because the entire facility functional 24/7. It means we will have some rooms for a short stay, 2 days, 3 days. So if mommy and granny and papi had a stay somewhere, they'd stay there. If it requires a longer, more extensive stay, we have the four hospitals. And I'm willing to say, if it cost us $41 million to operate 41 first world mini hospitals, one in each constituency a month, and we're willing to spend $500 million to run the hospital, the four hospitals we have, where the rest of the money that these governments, PNM and UNC, where that money? Where that money? Somebody just messaged me. They're selling medical grade latex at $28, government paying $60, and they know. I have sat with enough people who've told me of instances where they have provided government savings on all manner of issues, and government turn them down, or government go to their preferred suppliers and tell them, get this, we want this, somebody come to sell us this. I sat with a pharmacy owner who told me a senior minister waited to get his $1 million bribe before they could order certain emergency things that we needed at the height of a crisis. This is an insane country. I want to talk to somebody now. I tell you, this is not going to be easy to listen to. I'm calling. Ramona?
Yeah, hi.
Ramona, this is Philip Alexander, and you're live.
Yeah.
To the audience paying attention, I want you all to tell me that you're hearing. Ramona? I think I just lost that call. I want you to hear this, huh? To pay attention to this. Ramona, we got cut off.
Okay.
Ramona, I have been following the story that you've been telling, and it has been breaking my heart. There's some noise in the background by you.
Okay.
You're hearing me, Ramona, you're hearing me?
Yeah, I'm hearing you.
What's the noise in the background? Could you turn off any other devices behind you or walk away?
Hello?
Yes. Ramona?
Sure. Turn off the device behind you, the computer.
Yes, please.
Yeah.
Or you need to walk away from it. You're too close to the computer that broadcasting what I am saying.
Okay, we're not there anymore.
Ramona, I still hear in the computer. Ramona? Okay, I'm gonna call her back. I don't think she's understanding. And if somebody is listening to me on the device where Ramona is, you can't have the phone in the same room with that device. It's going to cause a problem. And we need some, we need to hear clear.
Right, I can speak to you now.
Ramona, the video will be available after. It will be on my Facebook and it will be on YouTube and you can listen to it in its entirety after.
No problem.
The purpose of this call, Ramona, is I have been watching your story and it's been breaking my heart, and I have not seen anybody giving you a platform, and I wanted you to be able to tell your story to Trinidad and Tobago, what you just experienced in public health in Trinidad and Tobago.
Okay, my husband is right here as well, right? Because it's both of us was, we took turns with my grandson that died, right?
You tell your story.
Okay, so I had a friend over last week Sunday, not a Sunday, the one before. Her daughter apparently had the flu. Now, I really don't take my grandson out in the public where people can touch him and stuff because he's kind of delicate. So we didn't want anybody to give him any bacteria or anything, same thing as the flu. But she came here and her daughter had the cold and fever. So when she left, Sunday night, he had a fever. So I went to the pharmacy. I said, what can I give my grandson? He's one. They said, give him the Panadol. It's the safest thing. The one with the little dropper. So I asked, how much? She said, 1 ml. So I gave it to him. Monday, I went to work. When I came home, after my daughter said, Mommy, Tita, I still have the fever. So we give him a cold bath. We put a couple of pieces of ice and some water, and we bathed him. The next morning, I saw like he had a sore throat. And he didn't want to eat. So I called my aunt and I explained to her what is what. She said, here what? Child groaning. Take him to Mount Hope. Take him to the hospital. And I will see him tomorrow, which was Wednesday. So I went up Sour Hill to look for a doctor there. In the health center. Sour Hill Health Center. There was no doctor. The nurses on duty told me, well, if we were high, they took his temperature and stuff. So we took him, bathed him. After that, I put some cold compresses under his head and under his arm between his leg. And they called the ambulance. When they called the ambulance took me to Mount Hope. So we went, with my husband and I, both of us went in the ambulance. So when we got there, the nurse then took his vitals and things. I explained to him, I said, he is a hypotonic baby, which means he has low muscle tone, so he can't roll, sit, stand, or anything. They took a note of it. They put his fever was high. So we ended up into the emergency. When I reached inside, she said, follow the green steps. When I reached inside, the nurses and them, they took him. He had a set of doctors around him. They put him on the Ventolin, the nebulizer. They put him on that. They put up IV access. So he had drips. They put... something, whatever they call that, would have put on that access, they put access on his hands. So they could have taken blood XYZ. So when we got there, after the 2 hours we got there, which was a little bit after 4. By 6 o'clock, my grandson was sitting up. I put the picture up watching me. So I had a little talk of dog piece in my hand. He loved his belly. So he was watching. I said, Grand, you want some? And he watching me, and you know, he kind of smiling. So I asked the doctor, I said, can I give him some Pedialyte? Because I find around his mouth and they were dry. So she said, go ahead, but don't give him too much. I give him half, but he done it in 2 seconds. They said, I'm going to put back on the Ventolin. They give him Ventolin back to back. Like for like 3 hours straight. Then coming up to 10 o'clock, they said they'll do it every half an hour. Now when the Ventolin off, they really leaving it for half an hour off. They putting on the oxygen mask, right? A little oxygen mask they're putting on him. And within 5 minutes, I see the Ventolin back again on him. So I was asking them why they're doing that. They said that because his infection is so bad, he's wheezing. The next thing is, I told them that my daughter is allergic to Augmentin. And anything that's in it, she's allergic to. So they did skin test. When they do the skin test, his hands got red and it was swollen. Well, but the patch where they did it, so they say he's allergic to that. So they told my husband to go downstairs and get, cannot remember the antibiotic at present. But he went downstairs in the pharmacy and he got the antibiotic. And they gave me a syringe to give him. That and ibuprofen. Right? I'm seeing that they said they give him Panadol. Right? But I didn't see they're giving him any Panadol. I told them give him ibuprofen. So after 11 o'clock, I left to come home because I have other children home. And we were trying to keep our Thanksgiving for him the next day. So we had to put things in order. We had to put, like, get the things arranged for the next day. So my husband will take over now.
Hi, good night, everyone.
Good night.
My story is a little difficult to tell because it's not going to have a happy ending. But
no, I know, and I really appreciate you taking the time to make me call. I just want to ask you to speak a little clearer into the phone because we're broadcasting this line.
Okay, but my voice is almost gone. It's now starting to come back. I sat there with my grandson throughout the rest of the ordeal until it took him from the room to crying to the morgue, I guess, all after said. And I noticed everything, the monitors, how he was breathing, how he became thirsty. I would give him a little bit of juice the first day. I would try to comfort him. I would rock his foot. And when they came to took blood, when they interfere with the vitals and his hand, anything that irritated him, I would try my best to comfort him while he was obtaining the medicine. And while he had the nebulizer over his mouth, anything that caused him a little irritation, I would do my best to comfort him. I stayed there whole night into the morning, into the next day, came back late in the evening, and I left a little while to use the bathroom and to freshen up and whatnot, and came back about less than an hour time. Sat down there, and you know, everything was still proceeding okay, you know. And about a little after 4 o'clock in the morning, they had already told me that Daddy, they referred to me as Daddy, we want to put a tube in your son's insert a tube inside your son just in case his breathing should get worse to assist with his breathing. At the time, the spirit says, well, you know, if it's to assist with his breathing, surely it must be better than if, you know, anything should go wrong, they could revise him or whatever, they'll put the oxygen. And that was the train of thought I got when they said to assist with his breathing. So when the doctors came in and says, we're going to insert the tube inside your son now, and I said, okay. And I was sitting at the child bed. I had one hand in my right hand, and I was rubbing his leg up the rest of his hand off the bed, and I got up off the chair and I moved aside to the and allowed him. I saw one doctor came in, the next one came in, another one, and pretty soon his bed had four on one side, four on the next side, and the head doctor was behind. And so I stayed stand back watching. kitchen for the child flat down, and they proceeded to do what they were doing. And I'm watching the child and watching the monitors, and watching the child and watching the monitors, and watching the child and watching the monitors. And somewhere along the line it went wrong, because I saw blood came through his nose, came out his mouth, and as I was close by the door, because I'm moving, I ain't turning up one place, I want to watch this moving on. You know, they sort of block around everything, but I want to watch to see what's going on. So I'm looking for the best place to see between the doctors and them. I want to see his face. I see blood came out in nose, blood came out in mouth, and all I bawl, oh my God. And I look away for a second because I couldn't bear to see what it is. As I said, oh my God, and the blood came out, you know, they wiped it instantly, and the two or three of them turned around to watch to see if I was watching them. And I just bawl, oh my God, and I turned away for a second. When I look back inside, all I could saw this big pool of brown liquid on the child. He had a little pillow that we brace his neck. So he, because all my wife explained, he's hypotonia, so he has no muscle tone. So this was to keep his head in one place, on top of his pillow, and on the bed, this big pool. It covered like if you throw a little cup of water out, it's flat around. And it, I bawl out to the nurse, I said, "Nurse, what is that?" He said, "Oh, there is some liquid that come off of the child. I said, "Yeah, but so what's wrong with him?" He said, "Oh, we give him a sedative just to relax him. He okay. Don't worry, he okay." I was like, oh my God, what's going on? I said, really start to pray. And I just leave the room and I beg God to come and protect this child. Time I come back into the room, I see the start to press down, up and down on the child's belly, up and down on the child's belly, up and down on the child's belly. I start to worry, but I'm watching the child, I'm watching the monitor. So, okay, whatever it is, it's only the amount of them around there, surely nothing could go wrong. And I'm praying in my mind, but I'm watching the monitor. I see everything, nothing going like this long straight line. I'm watching. Must say about 10 minutes, one of the nurses inside there, or one of the ladies inside there came to me and said, you may need to call somebody. I said, so what? I said, what are you telling me? I said, don't tell me anything wrong with my child. I said, please don't tell me anything wrong with my child. Call somebody for what? So she backed off and left me for a little while. Then a few minutes again, she came back. You really need to call somebody. I said, who you want me to call? Who you want me to call? He said, well, you don't want to call your wife? I said, my wife? Well, I'm thinking, well, maybe, you know, it's starting to get a little serious. Or it's serious. So I'm going to call she and tell her, well, Mona, you need to come. I said, but my phone ain't working too properly. She said, you know, you could use their phone. And we used the hospital phone, and I called my wife. I said, Mona, first I wasn't getting through, and then I finally got through. I said, Mona, I said, only get up and pray. Get up and pray. I said, only come as quick as I can. Don't waste no time. Come as quick as I can to the hospital. And I hear it screaming in the background, and they hang up the phone. Then I reach back in the room. All I see they're doing is pulling sheets down, pulling the thing that was an ED child, and pulling out monitors, pulling out this, pulling out that, pulling out this, pulling out that, out of the child. I say, oh my God, what are you doing, my child? I said, give me my child. And I reach in to pick him up off the bed, because half of them don't move out the bed. They're just scrambling to pick up whatever. I don't know what they're picking up with. With them moving in speed to move this and move that off the child. And they're just moving aside, and all I do is reaching and pull the child and starting to pick him up the bed. They say, give the father the child. And it had like something was in foot. The one was on one, two, one was on the other foot, and they just take everything, and I sat down on the chair. I feel one of them pull me backwards and I'm holding the child, and I remain there for a week trying to wake him up. I said, die, get up. Oh God, die, get up. Oh God, no. Die, get up. Shortly afterwards, my wife came inside the hospital room, and she started to bawl.
she started the ball and remained behind the room, and I said, we like we couldn't come to grips. We couldn't come to grips because just a few minutes ago, the doctor came in the room. I was holding the hand, and I couldn't come to grips with what I see because it was just a tube to assist with the breathing. The child was breathing. The child was breathing. I couldn't come to grips. I holding my son in the hand. I couldn't come to grips. And my wife was before.
Yes, back to me. So, after that, we went home because they called the police to us because we are trying to take the child home in our minds. If we take him home and carry my mind, he will get better. You know, sometimes you just kind of go off and it's a moment of insanity. So anyway, my aunt came and we went back to the hospital to see if we can meet with the doctors and they who attended to my grandson. When we got there, they didn't have the decency to say at least one of them stay around to talk to us. They sent another doctor Anyway, when the doctor came, the doctor started to ask us a question like, if anybody in our family has hypotonia. So I said, what stupidness are you asking me? I say, hypotonia has nothing to do with him being dead, right? She's like, no, it could have contributed to him if it's his lungs wasn't properly developed or something like that. So during that, she made a statement that he got another x-ray from the initial one. What I held the baby, right? She told me to keep him upwards and they gave me something to put on. They told me to hold him up so they could get a chest x-ray. When they brought back the results of that, they said it's the right lungs that had an infection. When the doctor who was speaking to us that day, she said that the infection had spread because they got a blood test and the blood test states that the infection had spread. So I said, how can that be if he was in the hospital? You were not supposed to be giving him treatment or antibiotics for the infection, right? She said, because when I went there Wednesday to see him, my daughter and I went Wednesday, and I asked the nurse on duty, I said, did he get his medicine? Did he get any? I said, only give him any of the antibiotics you sent us for. She said, no. Right? So, which means he didn't get antibiotic, right, at the time. Then, the next day we had another meeting with them, because this doctor, she couldn't tell us anything. Because she said he had blood in his lungs, beside the blood, the hemorrhaging was for the blood, right? Beside the blood in the lungs, he got a different type of antibiotic that we didn't even know. They were giving him something else in the trips to open up his airways. Most of the names I don't remember right now, right? Anyway, they said they're bringing the team who was there, which was the head of the department and the consultant on duty. When we got there, the consultant told me that she said both of his lungs were infected, right? So my aunt asked him, before it reached to this, how it is you only had the baby in an oxygen tent? If it is that his breathing was so bad, why you wait till the last minute then to push his tube down his throat? That's not making sense, right? Because if it was so bad, you won't have that call to make. And you never made that call. They say, oh, they had ICU there. Now, how can ICU be there when this doctor before told us that it had no beds in ICU? Right? Why wasn't he taken up from there and admitted to the ward? They say, oh, it was a crash. It was in crash site or whatever. Right? Now, the pathologist telling us today that we brought in a very sick baby. Yes, he was sick. But he was not sick to the point of death. And if it is that both of his lungs is consolidated, consolidated to the point that he died from pneumonia, what is this really did you all diagnose him from the beginning for? Was it a wrong diagnose? Or you weren't treating him for the root of the problem that he had? Or you didn't know? You just didn't know. It wasn't a mistake.
Ramona,
yeah.
I need to interrupt you for a minute. You are not a doctor. The purpose of the hospital, it is their job to diagnose. It is their job to treat. They can't have you second guessing what you thought it might have been. That's not your job. That is their job. I want to ask you a question.
Yeah.
What did they tell you was the cause of this child's death?
Trilateral pneumonia. Which means at that, his both lungs were infected, not just the one when he came in, it was one. They said both. So his lungs were like livers. Instead of being spongy and pink, the doctor told me they were blue and like a liver. So,
Ramona, I want to tell you, accept my sincere condolences. I want to do whatever I could to help you get justice. I need to ask you, is an autopsy being done to determine the actual cause of that?
Well, we were trying to get another pathologist, but he said that he has too much of work on his hands, so I don't know what that's just
going to happen. When we come off of this live video here,
yeah,
you and I are going to talk. I am going to talk to that pathologist. I want to see if I can involve myself and get you the kind of help that you need. I am terribly, terribly sorry that this happened to your family. This was madness.
The bad part is this was my first grandchild. I handled this child with so much care because he was a delicate baby. And then when we carried him in and I told him he had hypotonia, imagine if people put him to sit down. The child whole body, imagine this is a sick baby, eh? This child whole body went forward and his head hit the bed. You understand? It was really hard to see the baby.
How old was he?
He had just turned a year. 1 year, 1 week, and 1 day when he died. Last week, Wednesday, was his
birthday,
he turned one.
Ramona, we're going to get to the bottom of this thing. We're going to stand with you. The people who following you right now that know your story, they all going to be reaching out to you. You have a bunch of whole new friends and family now. We're going to stand with you on this, and we're going to help you get to the bottom of this. I am so terribly sorry that your family
had to blame us. They told us that our fault, the baby dead. That's what the pathologist told us today. That's what she said. We brought in a sick baby. How could somebody bring in a well baby in a hospital? I didn't carry it because I'm sure I'm positive Philip, my baby would have been alive tonight.
There's more to this story.
That story not adding up. We need an autopsy. We need an independent autopsy to what happened, what transpired here. This is ridiculous, and we need an autopsy. So that you could get closure and to prevent this from happening to anybody else. This is an insane situation.
When my husband told my aunt that the color of the fluid that came out from his mouth, she told me one time before the pathologist told me this, that he had a stomach bleed. How he get a stomach bleed? She said his stomach was thinning. How is stomach thin? You know, apparently he was hungry. And the ibuprofen, that's an old cause for something, but you know, nobody not admitting anything. Everybody just putting the blame on the parents.
Do you have, I think that you're going to have to start speaking with a lawyer. And I think all of the conversations now have to happen through your lawyer. There needs to be an investigation here. Somebody is to blame.
But I went to Mr. Keith Shotland already and he took up the case.
Well, Keith is a good friend of mine, so I will talk to Keith as well.
Please.
You and I will talk off air again further. Is there anything else you would like to say? And tell your husband for me, please, accept my condolences.
You should accept his condolences.
Thank you so much, sir.
It has more sadness because when we was in that room, well, we will talk about that off air because it was kind of everybody was trying to blame somebody else, and you know, so.
More to the child medical history. There's a little bit more to the child medical history and how
we get like the hypotonic in the first place. How we became hypotonic in the first place. There's a little bit more to the story. Mr. Kitt sent out letters to the different body requesting whatever the records and stuff, and to the chief executive of Mount Hope as well. So
just trying to come to terms
with this.
This child was supposed to be.
I was watching your story over the past couple of days, yeah. And some things I don't like to get political, But I realize that they're taking you for a ride, and I have been marveling at your strength, that you've been managing this on your own and trying to come to terms with this insanity. But I want to tell you something now. The Progressive Empowerment Party is standing with you, and we want to help you get to the bottom of what went on here. Okay?
Thanks. Okay, very much. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you. Thank you to everyone.
Thank both of you for having the courage to speak out here tonight. Thank you very much. I'll call you a little later, Ramona.
Thank you, Ramona.
So many things want to come out my mouth. But you know me, so many things want to come out my mouth now. If that was my mother and one of her grandchildren, if that was you, that was your child, we have to approach these things as one people. Now again, the public health professionals working in the hospitals at Trinidad and Tobago, working under the most extreme circumstances. I have had surgeons call me and say, Philip, tell people, don't come Mount Hope. Mount Hope, all the emergency rooms shut down, the operating theater shut down for pigeon infestation. I have had doctors and surgeons call me and say, surgery canceled, rat infestation. Somebody now sent me pictures of the maternity ward in San Fernando General Hospital, and they catch two snakes. What is going on? We're spending $14 million a day on public health. What is going on? Where is this money going? Who is getting this money? Even if it is malpractice, even if it is, but it can't be anything but corruption. You cannot misplace $5 billion. Our public health per constituency cannot cross $12 million a year. How is it costing $120 million? We are spending 10 times what we are supposed to spend in public health in Trinidad and Tobago. 10 times. I do not understand it. I do not. If you give West Shore and Sinclair hospitals $120 million to treat the people in the three Digo Martin locked down and safe. $120 million is a lot of money. What is going on? Whose job in this country is it to ask these questions? Where is the leadership? Where's the governance? Where's the management? We're spending $60 billion a year. How could we spend $50 billion in the past 10 years and have this madness to show for public health? If this was your child, what you want to do? All of we want to beat up witches. And I do this, and I do that, and I break this, and I cuss the police taking you out in handcuffs. Security guard rolling you out on the ground. The truth of the matter is, no matter what you think that you could do as an individual, you can't. You absolutely can't. The caretaker for Port of Spain, North St. Anne's West, one of the founders of the Progressive Empowerment Party, is a girl by the name of Lima McLeod Wilkinson. She works in the public service and she has three children. One of her children had an accident at school. Hi, Lima. One of her children at school had an accident and they had to take her to the hospital. I want Lima to tell you her experience at Mount Hope. Good evening, Lima. You're live.
Hi, good evening.
I just want you to tell Trinidad and Tobago the experience you had when you had to take your child recently to Mount Hope Hospital.
Good night, everybody. It was an accident in her pool. She tripped over her child and she fell and she broke her left arm. And we had to rush her to St. James Accident and Emergency, and it was around after 11. By the time I got there, it was about half 11 minutes to 12. The doctor told us that the arm definitely was broken and we needed to take him out. So there was no bus about it.
What time did it happen?
That would happen after 10 in the morning.
What time did you get to St. James?
I got to St. James about 11:30.
Okay, continue.
It was actually quick service in St. James, but I didn't mind. So I was actually happy about that. So I was thinking, yes, a little improvement here. We're good to go. So by the time I reached Mount Hope, which was around 12:20, we didn't take the ambulance because the doctor said she didn't know when the next ambulance was coming back there. So the better thing would have been to take her by car. So we took our car and we carried her. We got there 12:20.
Stop.
Yeah.
A public health facility expressed to you that you would be better off using a private car than waiting for a public ambulance?
Yeah. Because she didn't know how long the ambulance would have taken to come to the hospital and then to take us to Mount Hope.
Continue.
So by the time we got to Mount Hope, they have to do the whole check-in and sit down and wait for the nurse to call you. And by the time the nurse called and she saw her, she saw that the arm was broken and everything, she said that we have to sit down and wait for our name, for her name to be called. So I said, okay, no problem, because I'm going through the system. I don't want to be pushy and things. But I thought, you know, a broken arm was a severe injury, especially for a child under 5 years
old. But St. James Public Health Facility told you that they can't treat a broken hand.
They just put her, gave her pain medication.
No, but they couldn't stabilize a broken hand. That's what they told you. Because somebody else had a similar experience the other day where the child went with a busted chin. So I want to know, if St. James is funded as a medical center, if they can't stitch a chin and they can't stabilize a broken arm, what do they do there?
I don't know, because that means you have a lack of the specialist down there.
That is not specialized medicine. That is paramedic medicine.
The doctor herself was not a pediatric nurse or anything like that.
But you don't need to be a pediatric specialist. But you don't need to be a pediatric specialist. A bone is a bone. A busted chin is a busted chin. Anyway, you continue. You're in Mount Hope now.
So after we got there, after 12, we stayed there until after 4 or 5 somewhere else, when we actually saw a doctor. And by all that time, I had to be going back to them asking for pain medication for her, because it would have been wearing off all that time. And after I saw the doctor, he told me that the specialist is there, and he said that we would have to put her to sleep to fix the arm. And he said we would wait 2 more hours because he wanted her stomach to be completely empty before he did the procedure. So I said, okay. I told the doctor that I was leaving to go home because we live Belmont, which is not too far, and it takes 2 hours. I really didn't want to sit down in the hospital for another 2 hours. I've been there since 12 o'clock. So we came home, I changed clothes, I have other children to sort out, and I changed her clothes and pajamas and everything, and we went back to the hospital. We got back. The doctor said 2 hours from 6 o'clock that they would have done the procedure, because by the time they assessed her and everything, it was already after 6 hours, and that would have been 8 something. So we got back before 8, and the doctor was not there. I guess he was making rounds or something. We actually had the procedure after 9. So we left Mount Hope at 10:30 that night.
So it took
took
10 hours from the injury.
Yeah, so I practically worked a whole shift in Mount Hope.
As funny as that is, I'm trying to say that.
And the obsessive part too, so one of that is.
Was it a compound fracture?
The pardon?
Was it a compound fracture?
I'm not sure exactly what that was. He didn't explain it like that. He explained it in layman's terms that the bone itself on her forearm was broken and twisted. So he had to twist it back and then ship it back in.
Alright, let me tell you something, right?
Yeah.
at midnight, almost exactly midnight, on the 10th of October 2008,
yeah,
a truck broke a major road and crashed into my car. And long story short, I was rushed to hospital. I was driving a Prado. It flipped in the air and spun around. By the time it came to a stop, my arm was broken, completely broken, and gushing blood. And I was rushed to the hospital. I got to the hospital. I don't know the time, but I know the accident happened at midnight because we left where we were at midnight, and it was a block away the accident occurred.
Okay.
And so I had to have been St. Clair Medical Center by half hour max. And within 2 hours, they had done 21 x-rays. And the doctor who was handling me called for a specialist who came in by 4 o'clock in the morning. He was assessing me. He called for international support. Godfrey Araujo, man saved my arm, this arm that I am holding up in front of the screen. By 6 o'clock that morning, so I'm there 6 hours, he woke me up to tell me that I had to have surgery because my arm broke in multiples of places. They called it a crush. And in less time than it took for you and your child to get your bone set, I had surgery that attached an external fixator to my arm and stabilized my bones and was sent home.
And you know what is also upsetting? You're already angry to that point because you've seen a child that cannot identify with his pain. So after all of that, you're leaving it to the hospital pharmacy is already closed. You have a hunt out for a pharmacy open for the medication. And guess what pharmacy happens to be open at that hour? Super Farm. Right? So it's like a system that just broken right through. And when I asked the doctor, because I was up and down, every doctor here asking, you know, what about, you know, this child has a broken arm? Yeah, that's not critical enough. So my guess is I was supposed to take the ambulance and reach up in the ambulance and run out that ambulance screaming and crying for immediate attention.
Lima,
otherwise, you have to sit down and wait.
Is your baby doing okay now?
Yeah, I have to carry her. She did. We went back for the follow-ups and everything, and they said it has healed well, and she shouldn't have any problems after that. But I just want to carry her for a private checkup, just to make sure that there was no public slip-up anywhere, just to be extra, extra sure.
Thanks a lot for sharing with us.
Okay, no problem.
That shows you. That shows you what parents are dealing with. What parents have to deal with in this country. What citizens have to deal with. I want you to hear something now. You need to hear multiples of experiences, you know. The deputy political leader, one of the two deputy political leaders of our party, Sarah Nadi, had to be rushed to, I think it was Port of Spain Hospital. I want Sarah to tell you her story. Because, hi Sarah, you're live.
Hi.
Good evening.
Hi, good night.
Sarah Nadi is one of two deputy political leaders of the Progressive Empowerment Party, and she too had an experience in public health in Trinidad and Tobago. Sarah, would you care to tell your story?
Sure. It hurt us. I mean, as a viewer, I'm listening to both of them, and you know, my heart, and you know, but sure. A while back, I it was at night, around like 7:30 p.m., and I was over my stove and I was cooking, and I got a very sharp pain along the left side of my body, say from the chest up to the top of my head, but it was highly concentrated just strictly to the left side. It was such a severe pain that I almost collapsed onto the stove, but the instinct was to just throw yourself backwards so that I didn't fall on the fire and the pot, etc. But because of my knowledge and past experience with the public hospital, I self-medicated that night. And I basically could not, I couldn't function. Now, add to the stress that where I used to work at that time, I am only entitled to, I'm on monthly contract and I'm only entitled to 1 day sick leave, right? So, that day I spent home trying to get better from this headache, from this chest pain, from the left side of my body that was numb, right? And I couldn't take it, and I ended up going to a GP, and the GP examined me and said, basically, I need to get a CT scan. So I said, okay. And at that point in time, the only option I really had was the public hospital, because I couldn't afford it privately. Or if you scrounge, you know, you could find it, but really and truly, you know, you're at the mercy. Where I am and how I am is that I'm at the mercy of the public healthcare system.
No, but I want you to understand, before you say that, because I told of an experience just now where my friends rushed me to a private hospital, and I really believe, and in my photos, there's an album called The Accident and Other Oh My God Moments, and people could see the extent of my injuries. And it took 4 surgeries to save my arm. And I readily believe that had I gone to public health, I'd have lost my arm. It was it was such a bad damage that a public health doctor might have deemed it. It took 20 screws and rods and all sorts of things to break to rescue my arm. But I want you to understand something, that public health takes $5 billion. It takes 8% out of the treasury, out of the budget. It takes 40 million of your dollars every single day. Plus, every job that you've ever had, you've been paying national insurance on top of that. So I don't want you to think that you should feel bad that you couldn't access private healthcare. Public healthcare in this country is supposed to be first world and professional. This madness should not be what we experience then. Anyway, tell your story.
Yeah, but so understand that at that point it was, we reached in the hospital about like 7 p.m. that night. And the pain I'm talking about that I went to casualty with that night was, I had a referral for a CT scan, yes, from the GP. And she said that this would hopefully like make things a lot easier. And the pain that I had was one where if I breathe, my chest is hurting me, that I can't breathe and I want to collapse. My head, I can't hold my head up. My left arm, I can't move it. I can't understand it. I can't function properly. And I sat there and I waited a couple hours. So by this point, I'm leaning on the person who carried me. I'm leaning on my partner because I can't prop myself up.
Where are you at this point?
In casualty in the hospital.
Which hospital?
In Port of Spain General Hospital, casualty. Right? And this is around after 7 p.m. at night. And I got in there, as in through the gate, you know, when they call your name after you register, it took a couple hours to get registered and wait for your name to be called. When I got in, the doctor at the gate, that examination took 5 minutes. She took my CT scan, referral, she read it, she folded back the paper, put it in the envelope and told me, put that back in your bag. You could get a CT scan tomorrow, privately. You're not that urgent. I stood up, she watched me, she pushed me on my chest, and she said, your pain in your chest, it must kill her. She said, and this is, I'm standing there talking to her, telling her how I felt, and this is what she did. She told me to stand up, she pushed me, she watched me, right? And then she said, put the referral back in your bag, you could get her privately because you're not urgent. That's what she said. She said, I'm going to write you up for painkillers. And I was standing up there by the nurse's station waiting to get the Panadol or whatever it is that they prescribe, right? And while waiting there, you had to lean up there now because there's a line there too. It is now about almost 11 p.m. at night. And while I was leaning up, because again, I haven't gotten any relief, any pain, any pain relief whatsoever, I'm looking for places to lean up because I have nowhere for you to sit. Right? I have about 15 people before me. And somebody who, a doctor who was shift, didn't, like, did you come in for early shift or something? I was literally just, like, walking past, and they noticed me, and they're like, what are you doing here? When I told them what happened, they said, what? They said, hold on. They went back to the doctor's station, and he got, a doctor who was on, who saw, so it's like, I didn't pass my test, my information, nothing even passed that first screening doctor that was stationed at the gate, right? When I told them what happened, they asked me, where is this referral? I said it in my purse. They said, why is your CT scan referral in the purse? I said, that's what the doctor told me to do. She said, that's supposed to be added to your file. May I see it, please? I'll take it out. They put me there. They take my blood. And they said, you have to be admitted tonight. You need to tell whomever with you.
When the first doctor was sending you home?
Yes.
And the second doctor said you were critical and warranted an overnight stay?
Yes. They said because of the nature of my injury, they needed to test me to see if there was a transient ischemic attack, a TIA, because they wanted to see if I had a mini stroke or not.
So the first doctor could have been sending you home to die?
According to her, she was sending me home because I had muscular pain.
Continue.
Right? So by then, the shift is changing, in terms of the doctor's shift is changing. It is about after 12 at night. So mind you, we're there from after 7 to after 12. My partner had to leave to get, you know, some overnight things because they don't have pillow, they don't have things. They were telling me, you know, they stated, like, this is the things that I need to get. By 2 a.m., I was sent down for an x-ray, got the x-ray. By 3 a.m., right, the doctors were literally, this is what happened, I hear in the doctors, they're asking, and this is how they're talking, they're asking for favors from the other nurses on the ward, because the ward that I'm supposed to be on, the beds were full. And these doctors were trying their best to try and get a bed for me. And they were saying, I have a patient, you know, it's critical, she has to stay overnight. Could you do me a favor and keep me in your ward? And when I was there, and they took the CT scan, etc., I got about two. So I stayed in the hospital for 2 days. And in that day, in those 2 days, if you calculate the time of care that I got, I probably got about 30 minutes of attention in 2 days. And I was told that was a lot. And I ended up leaving the hospital. I discharged myself because remember this time I'm losing pay because I'm not being paid for my time. I don't have time off. I don't have sick leave. And I rested, waiting for the CT scan. And meanwhile, I'm like, okay, the pain in the head is up. No results for the CT scan. Nobody could give me answers. When you ask the nurses on the ward for Panadol for any pain, they are telling you, the doctors, they emptied out all the wards for paracetamol and Panadol because we have none in stock. Then they all have to go. The memo was that they have to go down to casualty. So you have no Panadol on the ward. You have no paracetamol on the ward. You have no painkiller on the ward.
Honey, there have been days where they had no bandages or blood bottles on the ward.
Yeah. You understand?
I get this daily. I talk to doctors and nurses on a daily basis. I don't just talk to patients. And I want Trinidadians to understand that it's not the doctors and the nurses to be blamed. They're these people working in hell. This is the first circle of hell. Satan running Trinidad and Tobago. Port of Spain General Hospital, Mount Hope Hospital, San Fernando Hospital, Scarborough Hospital, circles of hell.
So it's just that the point for me is that I personally don't know if I'm truly better or not because
so
everything after that.
They've never followed up with you?
I got the CT scan, like, not the doctor themselves, because remember, I ended up discharging myself. But they said that as an individual, you have the right to request the results. And I ended up getting the results about a week later. The CT scan results. About a week later. Or something like that.
And what, you took it to your private doctor?
I consulted with the GP after. And it was the... What they were telling me to do in terms of all that's necessary to run through, I couldn't afford it properly. right? So what I did is that I had to go at the mercy and the discretion of the GP in terms of the things to manage and care. So I'm really and truly not sure if it is that I have something that's hidden and latent and will stir up later, but because I don't have the avenue to follow through yet with it. But what I do is that I
didn't know that before. So you and I, we're going to talk tonight about that. Because I'm going to want some more information where that is concerned. Because we need you healthy and strong, okay?
Okay.
Thanks a lot for sharing your story.
Thank you. No problem.
The first people that talk to you black, that girl in there, here every creed and race find a suffering space. The public health of Trinidad and Tobago. While she was enduring that and Lima is a dogler. So all races, all creeds, come to public health in Trinidad and dead. Come on, dead. Come for somewhere to dead. And let me tell you, when you see the gear that flag at election time, wave it, you know. Wave like you know how to wave. But fire burn your mother ass if you or your family member end up in a casualty. You know what I tell you? Wave it. Wave it. Tell them, don't care, don't feel no way. Every story you hear tonight, somebody have a whole story. Every story you hear tonight, somebody have a whole story. Hi, good evening, Carla Jean.
Hello.
Hi, Carla, you hearing me?
Yes, I'm hearing you.
Okay, you're live, and I'm wanting you to share, if it's possible, your experience. You had a medical incident the same night that Sarah Nabi had a medical incident. She just shared her experience with the public. You were in Florida when you had your incident. Do you mind sharing that with the public?
Not at all. So I was working nights at the time in the neurosurgical intensive care unit, heading to work at around 5:30 p.m. And driving on the road, I suddenly got very lightheaded, couldn't see clearly. Obviously knew something was wrong. I pulled over. I called my work colleagues. I said, I don't know what's happening. My heart was racing. And I thought, okay, maybe I'm having a heart attack. I called 911. Explained my symptoms very clearly. Within, I would say, 3 minutes, the paramedic services arrived.
You are in your car on the side of the road now?
I had pulled over to a shopping plaza on the side of the road, but yes, within 3 minutes, the paramedics were able, once they knew my location, they were able to find
me. You were in the heart of a city somewhere?
Yes, I was downtown Jacksonville.
Okay.
And which is, by the way, the largest city in the United States of America per square mile.
Right.
And so,
so for ambulance coverage, is a big job.
It's a very big job. You have to have it designated per area or county, if you will. But yes, it's a big job in a place like this.
What is the population of a place like Jacksonville?
And so they were able to locate my exact position. I explained clearly where I was. They found me immediately, assessed me, worked me up. And I thought, you know, even though I was still conscious and able to talk, they thought, okay, I'm taking you to the nearest facility. Even though it wasn't even my hospital where I work at, they took me to the nearest facility where they got my paperwork, got everything done, did chest x-ray, did all kinds of things, EKG, everything done. Within a couple hours, you know, at that time, we still didn't have a definite diagnosis, but we knew for sure it wasn't a cardiac arrest, which was the major concern. The immediate blood results and everything within 2 to 3 hours. And once I knew I was medically safe, you know, I was able to go home and then do further testing outpatient. And from that point, outpatient testing honestly was not much of a struggle. I'm still able to go to my primary care, get appointments made. Just like Sarah, I was able to do an MRI, CT scan, and have the results available to me within about 2 days. No wait, no hassle.
In a city the size of Trinidad and Tobago, you hearing me, Carlogene? Carlogene, you hearing me? Carlogene, you hearing me? In a city the size of Trinidad and Tobago per square mile, there are roughly a little less people, an ambulance was able to come to you in 3 minutes. Yeah?
Correct.
How long you would say in hours it took you from the call to your being discharged?
About 3 to 4 hours.
Within that time, what kind of tests were run on you?
They did a complete chemistry profile. That's a bunch of blood tests. They did a chest x-ray, EKGs, urinalysis. Those were the basic things that were done within that time frame. Plus transport from my vehicle to the hospital as well. So all of that was done within 3 to 4 hours.
So this is not magic. This is not something that only happens in storybooks. This is something that could really be done. Carla?
Hello?
Yeah, you're hearing me?
Yes. Yeah, no, this is everyday. Even where I work now, are you hearing me?
Yes. It's breaking up, it's coming and going. But thanks a lot for making the contribution, Dokala.
Yeah, and I just wanted to add, you know, everything I've heard, especially from the first caller, Ramona, what I've heard, I mean, that is basic standard care that you get in Trinidad and Tobago, whether it's pediatric or adult. That type of inefficiency is commonplace. I went through it with my own mom. There's been no improvement in the past decade.
You had a sad story with your mom.
I had a very sad story with my mom, who contributed 4 decades to the Trinidad and Tobago medical system. And she had been seeing a pulmonologist in Trinidad. And long story short, came to visit me, went back home, called me to say she couldn't breathe, and next thing you know, she's in the San Fernando General Hospital. And that same pulmonary specialist who was seeing her insisted, oh, there's a pulmonary clinic in Mount Hope. This is the place you need to be. Don't go to any private facility. You must go to Mount Hope. And so, of course, we followed doctor's directions, and that's what we did. Could we have gone elsewhere? Yeah, but we chose to follow the doctor's directions. The pulmonary specialty clinic was nothing more than an empty room with oxygen. That's it. And throughout her stay, you know, she had poor care. There were even times where blood tests were supposed to be done. The nurses took the blood and forgot it on the counter. It's sitting there for a day. And then when we're waiting for results and we were inquiring what happened, we turn around and find the blood sitting on the counter. My relatives, you know, found the nurses and the hospital security sleeping at night on the floor instead of tending to their patients. We took pictures of that, and, you know, it was just a big travesty. And long story short, my mom passed away due to really inadequate care in Mount Hope. So I have a good story for myself, maybe, but a poor story for my family, for sure.
And you are in the public health industry.
Correct. And knowing what I know now, with all the training and experience I have, I mean, you talk about efficient healthcare. I can tell you that when our patients come in via helicopter, time from helicopter to emergency operation table, you're talking less than 45 minutes. That's how efficient healthcare should be run. That's emergency service. Whereas in Trinidad, a small island like Trinidad, someone can have an emergency, and even though the hospital is 15 minutes away, it might take them 2.5 hours to get there.
No, but
there's a problem with that.
No, but Carla Jean, I wanna try to understand how basic healthcare, like stitching a busted chin or stabilizing a broken arm, cannot be done in a health center.
It can be done in a health center.
But this is,
that nobody has taken the time to monitor these health centers, arrange them in an efficient manner, get adequate staffing, not just staffing,
no, but somebody argued with me. Somebody argued with me on Abigail Sinanan's thread when Abigail was talking about a family member who had one of these horror stories. And this person said factually that everybody in Trinidad knew if it's your child that's sick, head to Mount Hope. Now I want to know, if you in Mayaro or Sangre Grande or Chagaramas, why must you in an emergency situation have to head to Mount Hope?
Exactly. Because that shows a complete failure of what the government is supposed to be providing. The whole concept of a healthcare center is to provide care within that vicinity for basic needs, which includes stitching for a busted chin, as you mentioned. That is basic services. That is basic standard care. You should not have to head to a specialist center for something like that. And these services are not even delivered efficiently at these health centers, not at all. We heard of a couple crisis cases tonight, but there are hundreds of cases going on every other day. You look at the news, it's just another person complaining. My uncle died, my father died, my mommy died, my son died, my wife died in childbirth. This is not a one-time occurrence.
It is madness, Carla Jean, it is madness. There should be a state of emergency declared on public health in Trinidad and a commission of inquiry launched. To find out where this money, we're spending $14 million a day on public health in Trinidad, and I can't for the life of me find out where that money's going.
And not only that, Philip, the most important thing is, where is the accountability? Because this poor woman who called today about her grandchild, I guarantee you, if I was a betting woman, I would put money on it. I bet you nobody answers for that. Just like nobody answered for the woman who died in childbirth last year. Just like nobody will answer for the people who died in the hospital this year. There is zero accountability because in Trinidad and Tobago, medical professionals are looked at as gods. And nobody questions them for the nonsense that occurs. Do you know, I asked one question of my mother's pulmonary specialist. I said, for the past 6 months when you were checking my mother, what was her oxygen level in clinic? Because when I saw her, she was extremely gray in color. A simple question from one medical professional to another. Do you know, to this day, that woman could never tell me my mother's oxygen level? A pulmonary specialist having a patient in a clinic has no documentation of what my mother's oxygen level was?
That is insanity. That is pure insanity.
And this is what we accept, and this is what we think is normal healthcare. And the people, the citizens, unfortunately, do not realize that they have the power to say madness.
But because we get caught up in bullshit, Carla Jean. We look at what is the news. Look at what is the top story in the news in Trinidad. If somebody get hired in a school, but she wearing a hijab, so they don't want her to wear the hijab, and that become a whole big, and everybody, people dying in the hospital, and people arguing over the hijab.
Yeah, Bacchanal.
This is a country that specializes in bullshit. I watch a little Syrian boy, Gerald Aboud, make a comment on his Facebook page. The whole country going up in an uproar about that. They in an uproar about that. But Christopher Phillip, who got tossed out of the General Hospital, a black man. We want to talk race talk. We want to talk 1% talk. But where the 99% when Christopher Phillip was crawling around like a dog on the hospital lawn and dead?
Correct.
Where the 99% talk for him? We are bullshit. We specialize in bullshit. I am so upset. All of these stories had me so upset.
Correct. And the only time people feel it's a heart, Philip, and this is the hardest thing to say, the only time people feel it's a heart is when it becomes their mother or their son or their daughter. Then all of a sudden, oh my.
Oh God, I could send you. Mess, I could send you from my inbox. People that reach out to me, when they reach the hole in their head and bawling, when they realize that there is nobody, all of the things that they think that work, when they realize that there is nothing and that everything that I've been saying is true, and they come to me, what am I supposed to do then?
Correct.
What am I supposed to do then? I'm telling Trinidad and Tobago, listen to you. Listen to people like you. We have a sea of professionals in this organization that is telling Trinidad and Tobago, you're spending $122 million a year on Diego Martin West alone. And our first world professional healthcare could cost you 10% of that. We don't even know, as you say, where this money goes.
Correct.
You live in a country where a police officer called me to say his mother has been standing in the sun with her eyes dilated for cataract surgery alongside many other elders, for them to come out and apologize to them and say they have no lenses. Go back home, we'll call you back.
Yeah.
I have heard situations where people have been prepped for surgery and the surgery scrapped because the operating theater is compromised.
Absolutely. And the hospitals, considering the amount of money that goes towards healthcare, and I know this firsthand from seeing it with my own eyes, the hospitals are in poor standard. Poor, poor standards. There have been no adequate renovations or improvements to really move towards progressing this country to first world healthcare. We want to boast that we have oil and therefore we beg. But our healthcare system is deplorable, absolutely deplorable, to the point where even foreign people who come here for work are terribly afraid to stay here because they get just for the fear of getting sick here. I was deathly afraid when my incident happened. I postponed my Trinidad trip for 3 months because that's what was on my mind. What if one of these things happened and I happen to be in Trinidad? Will I end up like mommy? Do you know that's the thought that went through my head? How sad is that?
Ridiculously sad. Tragic. Tragic sad. Why it is sad? Why it is tragic sad, Carla Jean, is that we know that it could fix. We've
Correct.
Been playing race and gang politics in this blessed country for 56 years, knowing that all this bullshit could fix.
We know, but it's just a select few people who are brave enough to say it's time to make a change, because as a culture, the majority of people still have this mindset of bacchanal. Let's criticize the new people. They're not good enough. They will be just like the rest.
Why? When
they,
a jersey,
we don't like how they just talk.
An iPhone
like
and a jersey and a ham sandwich could buy a vote.
Correct.
Carla Jean, thank you very, very much for taking the call.
All right, my dear.
For all that she just contributed, she's a member of our advisory council. She is drafting our public health policy. Trinidad and Tobago, we have a team of professionals on standby. We have some of the best in the world here who will not work for any other political party and are willing to work with the Progressive Empowerment Party just because they believe that we will undo and redo the bullshit that passes for public service and public health in Trinidad and Tobago. Each and every one of those people who died, each and every one of them who died are entitled. And this is why the Progressive Empowerment Party at the bottom level, we've started with the ambulance service. And we are taking the ambulance service to court and the Ministry of Health. We want a justification. We want an investigation. We want a ruling. If citizens have died waiting on an ambulance, and that ambulance is paid to provide a service, shouldn't there be an accounting? Good evening, Christine. Hi, good evening, Christine. Hello. Christine, you hearing me?
Hello.
Christine, you hearing me?
I can hear you.
This is Christine Hossain. She's another member of the conversation we're having about drafting proper public health. She's a nurse practitioner based in New York. Christine, what would you like to add to this conversation with everything that you've heard tonight, especially from Ramona and her husband at the start and their little grandson that died?
It sounds to me like what that baby needed was a separate pediatrician. And in most hospitals in the UK and in the US, they have a separate pediatric department. So I'm not sure if Mount Hope has that. I haven't been there, but that is something that most advanced countries will have.
Christine,
two separate departments.
Christine,
one for adults.
Have you ever seen what Mount Hope looks like? Google.
You know, I have not. My father got treatment there many years ago, but I haven't seen it.
Google Mount Hope. The pictures that come up on Google. Just Google it and click images. As Mount Hope Hospital. Anyway, continue with your story.
So going back to the UK and the US, they would have separate departments. If a child is that sick coming into the department, the first thing they would do is obviously a chest x-ray. I don't know if they did a chest x-ray to the baby when the grandparents walked in, but the chest x-ray initially would have given them enough information to know that, you know, if this child had a pneumonia or it was just some sort of respiratory infection. But it sounds really terrible. Obviously, I wasn't there. I haven't seen the medical notes. I can't say if it's malpractice or negligence or poor care or whatever it is. But two things didn't add up, obviously. So I think, you know, the grandparents do have to pursue this, you know, in a legal sense, because they need to get answers and they need to have someone sit down and explain to them what happened minute by minute and what could have been done better, you know?
I want to ask you a question. Any of these stories that you've heard tonight, because as usual, my inbox is filling up by the minute with people telling their stories who are afraid to go public. But any of these stories that you've heard, you think that is how our public health should be operating?
Absolutely not. I can give you an incident I had in New York. I was eating almonds. I have algae. My throat was swelling up, and I can tell this is going to be a problem. I called 911. I was living in the Bronx at the time. The guy on the 911 call handler was Trinidadian because I heard his accent. And I said to him, I said, look, I need an ambulance. I said, I think I'm having an allergic reaction. And I was living on the 18th floor, and I said to him, I'm going to go downstairs now. He goes, no, don't go. Stay where you are. Well, I went downstairs because I didn't want to die in my apartment on the 18th floor, you know. Anyways, I went downstairs. The ambulance pulled up, like, within about 5 minutes. They treated me in the ambulance. They gave me intravenous antihistamine. They gave me steroids. They put an IV line in my vein to have it open, and then, you know, I was treated like for 10, 15 minutes, and then they took me to the emergency room. So I was treated on the spot, then and there. They didn't wait for
a disaster. But that's what emergency service is supposed to do. Anaphylaxis and to be able to intervene in circumstances where you're dealing with shock of any kind. They're supposed to be able to intervene and stabilize.
Right, exactly. They're supposed to stabilize the patient first before they can transfer you elsewhere.
Absolutely. This country spends a ridiculous amount of money on public health. Our four hospitals, Port of Spain, San Fernando, Mount Hope, and Scarborough, are mad. We spend $1.2 billion building the Scarborough Hospital, $120 million. It costs $100 million to build a first world hospital anywhere else in the world. I'm talking about complete with dental and ophthalmology suites. We're spending 10 times that to build a 2x4 shithole in Scarborough, Tobago that can't treat somebody for a scorpion bite. It is an insane situation that's going on here that's passing for public health. There are a couple companies that are using public health in Trinidad and Tobago as a laundry service to wash cocaine money. We have a mad government, we have a mad opposition, our parliament sitting down there playing bullshit games, talking shit. High class bovine excrement.
We need to demand more. We need to demand accountability. We need to demand better medical accountability as well. We need to have the medical board be accountable. You know, people should be able to complain about doctors and nurses and then have them answer for their actions like they do here in the States and in the UK. Anybody can complain about a nurse or a doctor.
But I've seen a mortality conference. I've sat and watched a mortality conference where everybody from the ambulance, from the call center operator to the ambulance driver, the paramedic, to the emergency room people and the hospital doctor had to give an accounting of what they did with this person.
Exactly. And that's how it should be. Open, transparent, everyone is accountable. And this is how it should be. This is what is done in other countries, and that's the standard. We're just asking for this basic standard. We're not asking for the sky. We're just asking for basic standard.
Christine, I want to tell you thanks a lot for all the work you're doing. I hope that you and Carla Jean getting through with the work that we're doing, especially from the position of organizing ourselves to have our 41 public health facilities ready to just push play should the Progressive Empowerment Party succeed in coming to government. Thank you very, very much for taking the time to share with us.
Thank you very much. Good night.
This is a country where, on a rumor, they beat a man to death. All the people involved in beating that man to death now trying to blame somebody else for the talk that they get, and they're not in custody. Ask the commissioner of police. Where's the police officer that had the shootout with the other police officer in Mount Hope, in Grand Bazaar? Grand Bazaar saw at the height of traffic in the day. If you ever go to Grand Bazaar, Grand Bazaar is a shithole of traffic. Killers were able to shoot and kill a man. Somebody with the same name as that man, that lawyer, trolling my post right now. I am sure a relative of his kill him dead and left in a mall where you can't come out without joining traffic. And if you come out of the mall, left or right, you're on highways, locked into a system. We have $1 billion helicopter service in Trinidad and Tobago, hundreds of millions of dollars in maintenance parts in a warehouse that the company that builds and sells the freaking helicopters, they don't have. We have. For helicopters we will never use. Jackass Rowley just spent billions of your money buying ships in Australia from a company that sold us ships that never worked. But the broker, the commission agent, is a PNM financier and a former minister, but cannot sit it on she ass because she know Rowley want to jail Munilal Ramlogan and she. So it's honor among thieves. So the same jackass contractors that rape we under Kamala, raping we more under Rowley, and the people sitting down and defending bullshit, you cannot sit on your hands anymore. It is not enough for you to pass Moveland talk about me and have nowhere else to turn. They're filling your head with bullshit. It is time to stand up. I am standing front and center, and I hope and I pray for the opportunity to face any one of my accusers in public, because I am on the radio 8 o'clock on a Sunday morning. You could call in live, my Facebook open to the world. If any politician in Trinidad and Tobago is available to stand for scrutiny, it is Philip Edward Alexander. And yet, sycophants and talking heads for Dyal Singh and the jackass Minister of Education, who is leaving our schoolyards open. They just found a boy with a gun in a school. I have been warning. I have written a letter. There is going to come a time when a stunt artist in Trinidad is going to open fire in on his classmates or on a teacher who just disciplined him the day before. Prison officers talk to me. Prison officers don't want to do their jobs anymore because a man in a jail cell that you discipline could call a shot on your family outside. The country is a shithole. A third world failed nation, banana republic, narco state. Your government cannot answer. These boats were only going to buy. It's the stunt. The Coast Guard can man and operate the boats they already have. Ask Reginald McLean. I want to put Reginald McLean in charge of the Coast Guard. I wish we come to our government. I will put him, Reginald McLean, because Reginald McLean could tell you where the Coast Guard boats are all the time. And it's easy for him to tell you because they always park up in Hartscott. So you tell me, you're buying boats. We can't operate the boats we have. We can't man the boats we have. You're buying more boats. What you going to man them with? Maliku? Anaguti? What going to man the boats, Rowley? But you're fooling black people and taking food out of their children mouth. The only hope and rescue for this country. Tell you, somebody send me a picture of snakes in a maternity ward. Where the ass we go in? Where we go in? You're buying boats. You can't afford the diesel for the boats you already have. But yacht owners getting deferred tax and cheaper diesel than car drivers. We living in a shithole. We living in a country where you're electing royalty to stunt on you. Jackasses like Colm Imbert, who should be sitting in a courtroom answering for his own freaking business. Look now, man. Trinidad and Tobago, we need to wake up, yes? We really need to wake the freak up. Might I get first world professional healthcare, but Ramona grandson had to dare too, and we just going about with business like lemmings, like peons, like peasants, like fools in a country that is a first world developed nation waiting to happen, but for the 41 stunting jackasses that we have in the parliament. How you feel, Trinidad and Tobago? Thank you. tell me about PNM don't care when Kamala stunk she ass for 5 years, spent $300 billion, tie we up in a deal with the Chinese for a hospital we don't need, we can't operate, we can't staff, we can't man, and walk out smiling she drunken ass, and health sector is still shit. Miss me with that bullshit, eh? When you type in PNM, make sure you remember the other side of that coin, the UNC. The pathologist needs $7,000. Link up with Ramona or link up with Ali G. Ali G is the one raising the issue with me. They need an answer by tonight. If you can assist in any way in helping Ramona and her family raise that funds, you can write a check directly to the pathologist. Ali, message Ali G. Ali will get that information and share it with you.
If their policy is a policy,
Keith Rowley so bad, eh? I want to fire that stunting son of a bitch, Keith Rowley, so bad. That erroneous, misguided imp of a minister of finance, Colm Imbert. I want to figuratively kick him in his ass, out of government. I want the entire bandit jackass clan of the UNC, Ram Logan, Munilal, Rambachan, the rest, Gopi Singh, all of them, all of come and stunt and fool and twist and divide the nation by race to pretend once a title string on your hand, we love your bullshit. Save all of that. Give us a country that works where people could live, where Mova beat them love until C-Lot in back of there and enterprise could go to the children, get proper healthcare. People, children not supposed to go hospital and dead. What kind of madness we running in? The Minister of Agriculture culture tell the nation today? Listen to this piece of bullshit. This is high-sounding bullshit. He is saying that they mining buffalo lips on it, costing the taxpayers money. What the fire truck you have to do to mine a buffalo? Buffalo living on the earth millions of years before man. Hundreds of millions of buffalo. They don't need man intervention. They don't need man help. If you want to control them, we have enough land in Kearney. You have to shut Kearney down. Fence and enclosure. All they need is grass and water. Miss me with the bullshit, Clarence Rambarat. The Progressive Empowerment Party will take the entire herd off your hands. Pep farms have 82 acres of land waiting for something to do with it. We will start back buffalo so in this country. Not certifying functional illiterates in a school system designed to frustrate. We have a public health sector that killing people. But the average person in Trinidad will never own a home. We just appoint an IMF man to chair the central bank. In a country where banks gone rogue, you don't get no interest on your money, you can't get foreign exchange, you can't get a loan. Bank job is to jam you. They need to hear us. They need to hear us. 1.4 million. We need to stand up. Wake up the country. I'm killing for us. We don't need no more of the damn wicked people. Fire the bondage. Commissioner reports only to the president. These are all established positions. The minister's position is not. Yet he keeps requesting for the deputy commissioner and permanent secretary to be suspended. There was an investigation. They were found to do no wrong. Returned to office. Now he's requesting it again. The minister has no control of the Public Service Commission. Yet he has written to them and to the Prime Minister to suspend and investigate these positions again. Is it because he wants his hands on land without opposition? Is it that he has a former permanent secretary working in the office? Land is a resource that they all want their hands on, minister included, and the property tax. The fastest thing they get is to go in Ernst & Young and put a set of Ernst & Young employees on an extra $12,500 salary and $4,500 traveling to come on your property to find out who own it. Or you're playing the ass, you know. Or you're letting a handful of shit snakes run amok in this country. It is time to stand up.
Influencing young ones to kill a boy now. He ain't no bad man boy now. He ain't no bad man. A real bad man works for whatever he wants, and he don't need no gun, he full of joy now. That's a bad man soldier. He ain't no bad man. So sit down, rock back. Tell them I don't need no strap to defend no people. I'm with it and evil.
All of you who say we need a call for early election, more than that, we need to organize ourselves. We need to have a political organization ready to do the job. This is not shits and giggles. This is not time for games. If people vote for the Progressive Empowerment Party, we need to have a party that is capable and committed to doing the job that we say we could do. It takes manpower. It takes operational expertise. If you have skill sets that you could bring to your country, come and bring it and make it available. We, the people of Trinidad and Tobago, have to take responsibility for this nation. It is not enough to just talk shit and post memes and laugh and joke and kill kete. It is not enough for everything to be shits and giggles. Think serious now, people dying. I want you to wake up, to stand up, to speak up, to be ready, to stand and say, we will not go gently into that good night. We will stand for our country. We will rescue TNT. It is time. It is time. She's asking for assistance. We in the Progressive Empowerment Party, we're going to make a donation. She needs $7,000 to pay for the autopsy to find out what killed her child. If you moved to send $50, you can send it to her directly. Ali G will give you the doctor name, so you know it's a PEP looking for your money. We're looking to help somebody. And there's nobody else for her to turn to but you. And just for a minute, picture you right now with a dead child or a dead grandchild. Trying to get answers. What happened here? And the doctor needs $7,000 by 9:30 tonight. What do you want to do? Somebody they tell me, Phil, your show is so long. We just watch them other people's videos, because them other people's videos is 3 minutes and 4 minutes long. Listen, this is not entertainment. This is your life. This is your future. To those of you who think that you're not into politics, that's okay, but politics well into you. Because the PNM government that's stunting after the UNC government shift that's stunting are raping and plundering and pillaging your money. The banks are jamming you and depleting your bank account, that's politics. The lack of foreign exchange to give you hope and opportunity and choice and diversity, that's politics. The fact that you can't afford food and will never be able to own a home, that's politics. The lack of water in your pipe in your house, despite spending enough money to put pipe around the earth 2.5 times, that too is politics. So if you feel that you're not into politics, politics into you. It very much into you. To say you're not into politics is like saying you, that lion ain't gonna eat you because you're not interested in eating the lion. Hear this one. I can attest to exactly what the caller is speaking about. Just give me 1 minute. Doing multiple things. I really need some interns now, yes? Some assistants. Let me see if that work. Yeah, it did. I can attest to exactly what the caller is speaking about. In 2008, I had the same issue in San Fernando. They sent me home saying it's muscle pain. This time was my appendix. After they sent me home, 2 weeks after, I was still getting pain and fever every day. When I started feeling a mass growing on my stomach, I went to my private doctor, who wrote up an emergency letter to the hospital. When I got there after waiting almost 5 hours, I called my doctor, who was surprised that I had still not attended, and he again called someone on staff, who immediately found me, and they started attending to me. My appendix was on the verge of rupture. They had to remove about 4 feet of intestine because the infection had already spread. If I had gone one more night, I would not be here today. Send your stories to me. 602-2110. Message me. WhatsApp me. You share the world.
I visited Bali and Chiba, witness an orchestra, a band, only politicians, great in their performance and style, talent and endurance, a band of Malaya material. Forces criminate, bridges replaced by gates. No joy in racism, prejudice and tribalism, only culturalism. Mama is up from the UNC and the PNM, COP in the political synthesis. Symphony, 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 the TOP, political
Banana Republic of do what the ass you want, lad. Go to the public health facilities. Go to the hospitals. Go and meet. I'm going to do a video. I'm going to do a live surprise video with the people who's open the doors when the medical companies come to drop supplies. You have to know what's going on in this country. The level of corruption and madness that masquerading for leadership. You think politicians run in this country? Politicians' job is to stunt on the front. Politicians' job is to create a money laundry out of the entire public service. You think public servants, doctors and nurses who sweep it on the ground to blame? Them in hell too. Them in hell. Patients, doctors, nurses, security, all of them in hell. And the jackasses, Goodwood Park, Fairways, Valsay, they're living large. They're eating nice and living well off your misery, traveling the world. The children posting Instagrams from Paris and London down. And you're taking that. And you're talking red and ready and yellow and steady bullshit.
You are.
Prime Minister, the Attorney General, Attorney General Junior Stuart Young, the Minister of Propaganda, cross the floor to the bunch of jackasses stunting in yellow from Kamala, go right back. Where do you have representation? Where do you have leadership? Come and tell me. Don't just give me red and ready and yellow and steady high sounding bullshit, because you know what these people interested in doing to you? The same thing they've been doing for 56 years. $3 trillion later.
That's what I'm looking at.
Vampire system is quaking in the face of this political organization. The copy and paste media has pissed on themselves. They've now painted themselves into a corner because they cannot answer as to how they have ignored the largest, fastest growing political organization in this country's history. How could you not at any point cover any of the 16 public rallies that we've had? Because we put more people in more places than Michaela put in her room. But you needed to cover that stunt because it works for your agenda. Because you know that no amount of posing and pussyfooting could bring financial dollars to bear on this organization. They know full and well that Philip Edward Alexander in government will mean justice will come to this country for the first time, that the DPP's office and the justice system will function. Understand, all of those organizations are creatures of the Constitution of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago. And it is why we say reboot the Republic. It is why we say undo and redo. It is why we say it is time to start Trinidad and Tobago over, outside of the clutches of the parasitic oligarchy that has two puppet political parties, the PNM and the UNC, making a mess of this country. On my wall, those who are not here to attend to this video, listen again. I need to say this, If you're not here for the politics, if you're not here for the Progressive Empowerment Party, this is not a friends and family line. This page, my personal profile, is all politics. That's what we do here. If you're not interested, a young lady, ask me not to tag her in any of the pictures, any of the posts we put out. I went one step further and I unfriended her. Because, lover, if you're not interested in the work that we are doing on this wall, why, for heaven's sake, are you here? This is not a place, this is not a dating service. Here we serious about what we here for.
Programs just in the world. In the world, sir, George Bernard Shaw, your tango, Mahatma Gandhi.
If you can look as far as I see, within this great land we call TMT, there's birds and bees, rivers and seas, pretty woman bringing man to their knees. Treasures of this blessed land we always neglect like Kaiso and Pan. I find it so strange the way we arrange. Still this nation don't know how to change. For some change it might just mean a new car. Change could mean less than a dollar. To most, change have this nice scent we usually get from the government. You see, change is something we always say, but every time we change, things remain the same way. Things keep getting worse and worse, so this is what I propose. Let's change the change for a better nation. Change the change for all foundations. Change the change so that we could say that this nation, yeah, came from quite down there. I say change the change within the school systems. Stop changing ministers and change what we teach them. But things won't change despite all we do if change doesn't start with you.
And I'm not trying to say it arrogantly. I am allowed 5,000 people as friends. I unlimited followers, and we have about 25,000 followers. The wall is open to the public, it is open to the world. If you are not interested in the actual interaction in the politics, it is what I am saying. There are 1,000 people on standby at any given moment that would like to get in and hear me. This is a mission that requires all hands on deck and nobody to just be warm in seats, alright? So don't take it personally. If you're not here for the politics, unfriend me. Stirling Leha, I see you just joined back. The song that playing is because of your request.
Is murders, killings galore, so much gunmen fighting needless war. I can't tell you stay, can't tell you go, but this still the land we used to know. Homeless, every corner you meet, and they complimented by a dirty street. Then we wonder why, in our sister isle, why they don't like Trinis to come and spend time. Well, you see, change is much more than paving our old road, and change is greater than fixing a lamp pole. Change is about the whole nation and how we are portrayed when the party done. Who set the standards in my TNT? I really wish somebody here could tell me. It's just the same thing again and again, like we leaders don't use the brain. So change within our country. Change so the whole world could see. Change for a better future, so we don't have to depend on society. Otherwise we'll have a bandit factory. But things won't change despite all we do if change doesn't start with you.
Hello, good evening, Felicia. Hello, Felicia, you hearing me?
Yeah.
You're live, eh? This is the chairman of the Progressive Empowerment Party, Felicia Holder. She's here live with me. Felicia, before you make any contribution, I was going to read something. Good day, Mr. Alexander. Sir, I am based in California, USA, and I do follow your live. I am seeking some answers to a situation that has hit home for me. I have lived in the United States since 78. In 2014, a couple years ago, I had to bring my mother to the United States with me. She suffered a stroke, and the caregiver was not giving her the best care in Trinidad. Last year, my soon-to-be 89-year-old mother had a leg amputated. Needless to say, she no longer wants to return home in this condition. I am her only child and do not feel safe and comfortable in a home down there. And here lies my problem. My mother has worked very hard all her life, and now her old age pension has been cut off since she was unable to appear in person. My question to you, is there any solution to this? And my friend, in the short term, the solution is to vote these stunting jackasses out of office. This ridiculous nonsense of a policy that dehumanizes the people who built this country is unacceptable at every level. This pittance that we pay our people for years of service, and in a country where the money practically has no value, that has to be addressed as well. Our elders need to be treated with respect. We need to open back up this country to give even the elders of Trinidad and Tobago an opportunity to grow old and age with dignity. And if that means being fully involved and getting involved in the country, they're welcome to do that too. We need to open that back. The Progressive Empowerment Party is the only political party that has, among all of its organizations internally, something called the Elders Council. You believe that? We have an Elders Council guiding us. Anyway, Felicia Holder, Chairman, good evening.
Good evening.
Have you been paying attention to what we've been addressing all evening?
Not fully, because I've been driving, and I am driving right now, but I know that we're talking about the failure and failed healthcare system that we have here, and just following the, you know, what you just read there, I can gather that we getting into the fact that governments past and present have done nothing to make our nation safe in terms of the healthcare system that we have. We can't rely on it. We can't depend on it. I myself lost my grandmother in the public hospital, and the conditions under which she died was really, it was something that shook me up for life, and I don't think anybody should have to go through that. It's not a healthcare we have, literally a sick care we have, because I've never known anybody to have anything major gone into a public hospital and not have some form of complication unless you know somebody.
Thanks a lot for that. The Progressive Empowerment Party right now, through Ali G, who runs our overseas chapters, Ali G is mounting a collection right now. Ramona needs the $7,000 to pay the pathologist to find out what went on with her grandson, how this boy who went in the hospital seeking some assistance was allowed to die under such questionable circumstances. And she should get the help. If there's nowhere else in the country that she could turn to, she should be able to turn to us, her brothers and sisters in Trinidad and Tobago. Stand together, reach out to Ali G, even if it is $100 you can pledge. Listen, people need help and we need to stand together. Until we can control and fix and right-size and rescue the country, let's work with each other to help each other. Felicia, is there anything else you would like to add before you?
Not particularly.
What about the fundraiser? The fundraiser.
Well, I was just about to say that. I don't know if this is the time to do that, but I mean, Trinidad and Tobago should know by now, if they're not hearing it on your live, we're not seeing it on our page, we are having our curriculum and fundraiser coming up at the end of this month, June 30th. We have not been able to reach out to all our overseas teams as yet, but anybody who would like to purchase a meal for somebody in need, we're actually making 300 tickets available for overseas, and I wanted to do it like a competition to see which chapter can raise the most amount of funds to feed the needy. But I think that would be really remarkable for us to go down on that day, on that evening, and be able to see that our overseas team helped us feed over 300 persons in the college field and in Byron area. So if you can't support locally or abroad, we link up with Ali G for abroad locally. We have tickets from any of our committee members. Help us grow this party, because what we want to do is take our message far and wide. And in order to do that, we need the funds. We're doing this the legal way. We're doing everything above board. And we just appreciate all and any support you can offer. And that's it for me. Thank you.
Thanks a lot for that. Felicia Holder, Chairman of the Progressive Empowerment Party. We have breadth, depth, length, organizational structure. We have a youth arm and an elders council. We have an advisory council writing the policies of the party, getting us ready for the day you put us in office. We just push play. We tell you that our first elected day in office, we will go into that parliament, convene the parliament, and not come out until recall is legislation. You see, Bastio Pandey and Dukeran and all of them are the bullshit stunting. Kamla Prasad Bisesa and Winston Dukeran, as co-partners in crime of the People's Partnership, had the numbers in the parliament in one day, the same way those stunting jackasses wrote Section 34 and unwrote it. They could have put recall, constitutional reform, the constitutional reform they're talking about. Bastio Pandey was golfing his drunken ass all over the country. Why he didn't deal with constitutional reform then? Well, you want to come and talk constitutional reform now? You're trying to get a walk for Michaela? What Michaela ever do? What Michaela ever do? I see her posing, hugging and kissing. We will make her the ambassador of hugs and kisses. All the has-beens and wannabes for politics who can't go nowhere, who just have plenty to talk but nothing to back it up with, we will put Michaela in the office and her job is to hug and kiss them all the live long friggin' day. But Trinidadians tired of stunt artists. We tired of circus and theater. We want a country that works with a government that delivers. And if you want to be a part of the coming change, the growing revolution for a better Trinidad and Tobago, join the Orange family. Stand with the Orange Army. Surf the orange tsunami that will clean this country. It is time for change.
In our youth, we leave all the weight, cause in most leaders, we done a lost faith. They full of such greed. Oh, Father, I plead, please, Lord, have some mercy on their seeds. Cause the youth are trying their best, but they're born in this place of lies and commerce. So eventually, when things get heavy, chances are they might turn out just like we. But you see, change could put an end to all this foolishness. Change could break this chain link of sadness. Change could help our leaders to grow and start preparing youths for tomorrow. Don't see change as something timely and start seeing change as your duty. To stop them from hurting one day is we had to point the way. So change the change for better transparency. Change the change for better economy. Change the change so no man one day will take we money and just fly away. I say for young Calypsonians, and stop saying culture is in good hands. But things won't change despite all we do if change doesn't start with you.
Use your vote to end the stunting. Use your vote to rescue the country. 56 years and $3 trillion is enough time for the bullshit artists to have bullshitted you. There are enough overnight millionaires, 100 millionaires and billionaires in this country that have no way to show how they arrive at that money. I tell people already, the Progressive Empowerment Party is serious business. If you stole the country's money, I don't care if your name was Johnny O and you're in the ground. I'm going after Johnny O in inheritors. I'm going to meet with the Prime Minister of Canada and say, brother, see them four Toronto skyscrapers? That and all the back rent since it built is Trinidad and Tobago money. So you want to play like we're a United Nation? Respect Trinidad and Tobago and what we entitled to. Give us back our money. And if you were one of the bandit clans from the early days, come right up through Clico, CL Financial, all of that. It is time for an open outpouring. It is time to ventilate, to show the country where the money went, because people trying to understand. If you spend $9 billion on the Ministry of Works and Transport and have to go and line up in licensing office for all these hours to get no kind of service, where the money going? It's not like it tripping and it falling and it going down the drain. Somebody thiefing it. Government ministers, politicians, friends and family and financiers, a deviant clan of business and professional class in this country that has permeated like a cancer every public office in Trinidad and Tobago. And we need to find them, root them out and prosecute each and every one of them. It is time to bring this country back to its first hope as a civilized paradise on earth. And then to grow, to develop nation, we need to get there. The only way we're going to get there is to face where we are and to move. And if we're going to do that, you need to stand with us and you need to tell them we're ready. We need to get ready. We need to register. Put your ID card in your pocket. Make sure your name on the EDC list.
We're ready.
Long time no name.
We're ready.
Come back to the election. We're waiting.
Yeah, we're ready. Look how the sun now raising up, and the cloud now waking up. The atmosphere half nice, and nothing can break it up. The carnival line now stop, we are the drinks that in a like up. We're gonna party all night, 24 parties we hit in a row. Tonight at the very last show, before we are out on the road. The girl never released the load. So let me see your hands up, so everybody know, put your hands up, so if you're ready for the road, let your friend them know. We're ready for the road.
Problem with public health in this country at any point, message us. The Progressive Empowerment Party is going to bring the court into the equation, and we are going to launch a class action lawsuit against the Ministry of Health on behalf of every single person in this country who has lost their lives as a result of the failure of public health to do its job, what it is paid to do. And it is time that that lawsuit force an inquiry. We need a commission of inquiry into the public health service where all the money gone. Manning, Kamala, Pandey, Rowley, $60 billion. You're telling yourself, where's $60,000 million anywhere you look? Miss me with that bullshit.
We're ready. We're ready. We're ready. We're ready. We're ready. Yeah, we're ready. We're ready. We're ready. We're ready. We're ready. The girl them a wait all week, figured up on the road like freak. The music full of bumpers, with thousands of chicken feet. Everywhere you look is just food, and everybody in a real nice mood. We gonna party all night, Everyone with painted body, clean credit and dated money. Nobody wanna dance by the safe, everybody wanna dance on somebody. Well, let me see your hands up so, everybody know where your hands up so. If you're ready for the road, let your friend them know. We're ready for the road.
For something will fall for anything. It is time to stand together as one people under one flag. We have in our hands the ability to fix this country. You ignore all the Maseratis and the Ferraris and the Rolls Royces in this country. Ignore them for now. We will deal with it after. Focus one thing. Build a political organization, lawful, legal, and just. We will do this the right way. We will get into office. We will get into office the right and decent, legal, lawful way. Call the election. We will shock you with the voter turnout. Call the election. Let CNC 3, Sabga News Network, and Massa Media give all the bullshit they want to give you. The newspaper is selling. I'm doing my little surveys. I'm going in the drugstores and the groceries. How the papers moving? Buy no papers again, you know. It's not selling. You can't fool the people anymore. You can't print for tomorrow what they discuss today. We don't want to hear Golda Lee Bruce and Kamal and Desha Rambachan talking bullshit about what we talk about already for the day. Akash Samaru is not a funny guy. He is not intelligent enough to turn and twist what we're dealing with into comedy. It's not funny. It is time to take it very serious. The country in trouble and we need to fix it. We need to fix it. Thank you for staying with me for this marathon session. I waited for Angie to tell me that she gave me $7,000, that she tried to help this woman pay the pathologist to find out what happened to her grandson. I want to know that we did it.
What for we, and we will set you free. Everywhere it was somebody chanting.
Felicia Holder, the chairman of the party, Satish Ramsaran is the head of finance. You could write a check to the doctor himself if you are moved in any way to help this lady. She needs $7,000 to pay the pathologist to find out what went wrong and how her son died. And I would like us to help. The Progressive Empowerment Party has committed $1,000 so far, and we will make sure that we will get this money to her tonight somehow, somewhere. We're asking for your help. Help us, please. Let us stand together with this woman. Should have bought, or the Ministry of Communication should have bought this song. And I don't want everything to be about bad news. We're going to help this lady and we're going to fix this country. But there is something sweet about being a Trinian. They have something sweet about being a Trinian that no matter where we go to the ends of the earth and we find it the best, the sweetest, the nicest. but we miss home and we miss our Trininess, and that can't be duplicated. It can't even be imitated. There's something sweet about being a Trini. And this song, if they don't buy it, if we come into office, I promise you, blacks, we come in looking for you. We're gonna buy this song and use it to market Trinidad and Tobago. Is the integrity of the people. Wake up TNT, show some class, respect each other. Let's make that our golden rule. I agree, brother. We don't treat them with the kind of respect that they deserve, and we kind of relegate them to wallflowers. And it's my father, you know, he's always a vibrant, strong, he shaped my mind in a lot of ways, and he was a guy that, he is a guy, but when he was younger, that, you see things like Panda and then talk about, if you see me fighting a lion, feel sorry for the lion, that's my father. I know my father walks with a cane, and I have a therapist that goes to see him twice a week to keep him mobile, and he moves slow and things. Today I was able to gift him his Father's Day. Now, for all of my growing up life, and all of the people who know me from Woodbrook and know my family, they know that on a Sunday, my father used to play his music loud for the whole neighborhood to hear. And that was his thing. He used to collect his records. And I was getting a little older. When his father's there, I kind of buy him a little record and thing to add to his collection. Anyway, I gave him a surprise today. Because his little stereo that he had, the turntable, stopped working over a year now. And I surprised him today with a record player, a turntable that jacked into the stereo system. And my mother bring out one of his records and I was able to play it for him. Big jackass like him crying tears. I had tears of joy, I guess. And I left him, I took a set of pictures and I left him sitting down there cleaning his records and playing his, and I felt good to be able to bring that kind of joy to my father. And I want to ask all of my followers, for want of a better word, and I don't treat people like followers because all of we at one level, and if you come in the progressive energy, you will realize, and people could tell you this, that I don't play big boss. I don't have no big boss delusions. All of we on one level, we operate on one level in that party. All of the people who work with me, they know me as Philip. I have no delusions of grandeur whatsoever. I'm happy just to be me. But to use the word followers, the people who are along with me on this journey, I want to ask you to start looking for ways that you could do things like this, to mend fences, to turn enemies into friends, to treat your family, your parents, you treat everybody with love, and let us get back to a point where that is our innate Trinidadianness, you know. That way we have that, we are an abundance of love, the people of this country, and I need us as a party. There must be something different about us, not just our ideologies, our policies, our philosophies that guide and change and open minds and liberates the people, inform, educate, and empower. Yeah, all that is great. But we must make sure that the Progressive Empowerment Party brings the concept of family back, family life. All of our policies are built on and around rebuilding the family, re-establishing the community, putting power back in the neighborhood, the crucible of development of all of our people. Our people have been scattered to the winds and isolated. We need to undo that. What we need to redo is rebuild the home. You must be able to go back and retreat to a place of love. Recharge your batteries there. We need to get back to that. Those are the kind of things we want to focus on. Ali G, tell me, where we are.
I'm gonna mix that crowd. That's where I am. To get the number one
source, but I'm gonna get the music. Every man loving right now, here we go. Say wine and hush, flex to the pants every pump and bust. Skip in the line, get a whining puss. Time gonna rip that engine rough. Your body or your best bet mixed with dust. Maybe wind up now, baby grind up now. Till you're sweating now, flex with precision. Make that water flow, and we're stalling now. And we're falling now. Say concentrate and mind that purse. Pull it up fast and give me that purse. Dung in the bush, this kind of wine on my high like kush. It will be my system and I aiming on my shots on target bumper ambush.
Baby, wine up now, baby, grind up now. Till you're sweating now, flex with precision.
Thank you for all of you who are with us for the marathon session tonight. We kind of bringing it to a close. We are $300 now. Ali G, what we need again, but that doesn't account for the Progressive Empowerment Party. We've committed to $1,000. Let's see what we could get. Anybody who could assist, we need to help this family. So thank all of you who have been with us for the duration of the show tonight. This Saturday at noon, 19 Stanmore Avenue, we're back, our public meetings. So feel free to come and join us. come and add your voice, join the conversation. Those who are interested in joining Pep Farms, if you're a farmer or would like to get into farming, you don't need any money at all. Just come to us and sit with us, and we can set you up and get you farming as part of Pep Farms. So come and join us this Saturday at noon. If you're still looking for a job, we have companies asking us to help us. We're doing a pre-screen for jobs. If you would like to come and get your name put down on the list, come and join us for that as well. What else is going on? Our new website is launched, pepptt.com. It is super, super sexy. Great job to the team. Pep Radio is up and running. Check it out. It's on the Pep app and it's on the Pep website. You can check that as well. We're doing a fundraiser at the end of June. We're doing that fundraiser. It's a curry queue and it goes into the consolidated fund that runs the party. We also are doing, right after that, 3 weeks after, we're doing an event called Peppers Who Can Cook, or Peppers Can Cook. And I am going to be cooking my world famous curry breadfruit. So get ready to join up on that, because tickets, as soon as tickets are announced, I expect that to sell out. Because we're going to have four teams of crews that are putting out four dishes, two a meat, a seafood, two veggies, and a dessert. And there's four teams. So once you buy a ticket, you can eat all four. So come and see Peppers Who Could Cook, Who Could Really Cook. And if you would like to get involved and join and help with that, you could come and do that. You can make a donation towards that. You can make a donation towards the party. We could use $10, $100, $1,000, $1,000,000. We are fighting a massive, massive dragon. We are fighting for the soul of this nation. This that has been burning, plundering, pillaging this nation for 56 years, the Progressive Empowerment Party is mounting a real, real resistance. We are going to change this nation, and we've done it. You've seen, we forced them to address and deal with issues on a national level, and we will continue to do that. We will stand our ground. We will not let our people anymore be molested and abused by public office holders. Trinidad and Tobago, we can fix this. We need your assistance. We need your help. Come on board. Join us. peptrinbago@gmail.com. If you want to join the party, if you want to message us, peptrinbago@gmail.com, pepptt.com. The Pep app is PEPAPP, two words, Pep app, and it's available on all app download sites free of charge. You can also reach us on 3474-PEP. So my phone ringing off the hook, and for some reason it's making the phone that we dial, that we film on, dial as well. So until we speak again, stay safe, John and Anthony.